Oh, thanks, everyone. I have two announcements. First, we didn't use Easy Cater for this meeting, which is why the food never arrived. Also, and I just thought of this, effective immediately, everyone will be paid in wildly volatile cryptocurrency. You're all now billionaires. And now you're broke.
Bad ideas happen when there's no food for the meeting. So make sure it's on time and as ordered from more than 80,000 restaurants. Now, Easy Cater.
You're rich again. And now you're not.
Order 24/7 on EasyCater.com.
Introducing Odyssey Exclusive Stations. We've curated hundreds of new music stations available only on Odyssey by music fans for music fans. Check out our Masters of Metal, playing the pioneers of heavy metal, or Katie Neal's Leading Ladies for a salute to the women of country. Like K-pop? Odyssey has that too. We've even invited a few of our famous friends to create stations just for Odyssey listeners like you. It's your pop, country, rock, hip-hop, 80s, fun, jam band, yacht rock. Soundtrack for your day by Odyssey.
Longtime big leaguer and now Astros TV analyst. Jeff, how are you? Thanks for joining us.
I'm doing great. It's good to be on with you guys. Thank you.
Yeah, Jeff, it's good to have you with us. I was actually talking about your home run in the World Series for the White Sox before, because I was saying that to our audience that, like, the first, like, you had a long big league career. You played a lot of years, but the first thing I think of when I think of you is that home run. Because you did you pinch hit or did you come in the game? I can't remember for sure. Refresh my memory. But you came in late in that game, and obviously it was extra innings when you hit that home run. And if the, you know, if you guys lose that game, who knows? Maybe the series goes in a different way. But that was a, I mean, that's a life changing game changer. We talk about Rajay Davis here. He wasn't here very long, but we'll always, even though the Indians lost the World Series to the Cubs, we will always remember that home run he hit off Aroldis Chapman. Every White Sox fan will remember your home run to the day they die.
I appreciate you saying that. It's always good to relive that memory because, like you said, it was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and fortunately I got a pitch I could handle and I hammered it. But, yeah, I came in on a double switch because that was when the series moved back to Houston, and we went
– right.
I came in the 13th inning, and I think I was probably the 24th player used in that game.
Wow.
So it took a while for me to get in there, but fortunately, you know, the stars aligned, and I happened to be at the right place at the right time, got a pitch I could hit, crushed it, and we went on to win 1-0 the next day. But, yeah, definitely a memory that I will never forget.
When you're circling the bases – like, do you even remember? Were you, like, in La La Land? Can you actually have a memory of going around those bases? Or were you so, like, high in the moment that you can't remember it? I don't know.
I hit it with two outs, and it was a low-line drive, and I knew I hit it extremely good. But my first thought was get to second base so I could be in scoring position. So I kind of put my head down and took off. And as I looked up, I saw Tim Raines about 4 feet off the ground with both arms in the hand. In the air, and I kind of realized that the ball had gotten out, and I gave it a pretty strong fist pump. And you know what? It's funny you bring that up, because I tell this story all the time, and I do not remember to this day touching first, second, or third, because everything just kind of went dark and went quiet, and it was just in the moment until I hit home plate, and everything kind of came back to life. But yeah, it's exactly what you might think it would be if you were in that moment where you just remember the elation instead of the actual act.
That's amazing. Every kid's dream. All right, Jeff, now, fast forward to now, you're a TV analyst for the team that you beat in that game, of course, the Houston Astros. Obviously, you played for the Astros as well. But, you know, I was just mentioning, like, baseball is just such a weird game. I don't have to tell you this, but, like, your Astros, you'd been red hot, right? You won 11 in a row. You'd been killing it. And now they lose 5 of 6 to the Tigers and Orioles. Like, how do you figure that out?
that's where my seat gets kind of tough, because you know they come off a 11 game winning streak, and then they split with Detroit, a team that they should beat. But back early in April, they actually got swept at home by Detroit. I don't know if it's the AJ Hinch effect or you know retribution for that scenario, but he got us. And then watching what they did against Baltimore, it was literally a complete 180 from the team that we had been calling for the first, you know, 3 weeks of June until those last 3 days of June, where they just completely, you know, we're not the same team. The pitching faltered, the offense faltered, the bullpen faltered. It was just a complete breakdown. And to be honest, this season, what the Astros have done against sub-500 teams has been astonishing, because they're basically playing 500 baseball against teams who have a record lower than 500. but against teams that they are playing that have a you know, above 500 record, like the Cleveland Indians, they go out and they play 29-19 baseball. So they're 10 games above 500 against teams who are above 500. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's funny that you say that, because we've been just saying the same thing about the Indians. The Indians have not played great against the poor teams, you know, the losing record teams, and yet they haven't. They've only lost one series to a team over 500 since the third week of April. They lost one series to the Blue Jays. Everyone else has been a split. It's weird. As a former player, Jeff, what do you make of that? Is there more focus when you're playing another team that's really good? I mean, what is it? Or is it just coincidence?
It's a little bit of coincidence, and it's a little bit of, you know, some of the other factors, because you do realize who you're playing against. As much as you say that, you know, we're going to go out and play our same game no matter what, you do realize when you have to step it up against some better teams and the competition's going to be ramped up. So you're going to focus a little bit more against those teams who are better, and maybe the focus will change a little bit when you are playing teams that are sub 500, or you assume that you're going to go out there and beat. But that's where baseball is kind of crazy, in the sense that the second you kind of pull back on the throttle, you get exposed. And that's kind of where the Astros found themselves. But also at the same time, you got to remember, you know, we're heading into the 1st of July. This is, you know, after a season where everybody played 60 games, and now you're in the mid-season at 81 games. So, you know what, fatigue and mental fatigue really do kind of set in around this time in that July-August area.
Jeff, what's an outsider's perspective on the Indians right now?
You know what? We haven't heard as much as we normally hear about the Cleveland Indians. And obviously with some of the roster changes and personnel that have moved within the Cleveland Indians, you know, you kind of go, okay, they're not as good as they were, but they continue to go out there and play well under Terry Francona. So you know that some of the talent is still there, even though some of the parts have moved without Lindor or Kluber, and you just assume that they're not going to be as good. But I think Terry Francona is one of those guys, like Bob Melvin for the Oakland A's, who just finds a way to get some of these guys motivated to go play baseball. So on the outside, you kind of recognize the talent has changed a little bit, but leadership hasn't. So you assume that they're going to go out there and compete and still play some very good baseball. And then, you know, watching inside that American League Central division, it's probably one of the more interesting divisions, watching how, you know, the shuffle between the White Sox, the Indians. Everybody expected the Minnesota Twins to be at the top, but they're not. So I think that the anticipation, at least on, you know, moving into this series from where I sit, is that maybe they're not the same team, but I know that they're going to go out there and continue to keep and compete and put up a fight against the Astros.
We're talking with Jeff Blum, longtime big leaguer, now the Houston Astros TV analyst. Jeff, let's talk about our old buddy Michael Brantley. He was a very popular player when he played in Cleveland. He was a really good player. Had some injuries late in his Indians career, and he's really bounced back from that. I know he missed a little time this year, but how important of an addition over the last couple of years has he been to that Astros lineup?
Well, first of all, just before we got Michael Brantley, he was just an absolute nuisance every time he was in the Indians lineup, because he'd be a 2 or 3 hit guy a night. He'd come up with a big hit, and by the end of the season, he was a 300 hitter. He comes over to the Astros, and we actually got to understand why he was such a good hitter, how pure that swing is and how hard he works at maintaining that swing. And he has been one of the more stabilizing forces on the field. But one thing, too, is what he brings underneath in the clubhouse. He's one of those quiet leaders that I think a lot of guys go to in that clubhouse to try and understand how hard it is to play at the major league level and how hard it is to maintain that level of greatness that Michael Brantley's been able to do. So he's provided some knowledge and some insight and some security for some of these guys who are trying to figure out how to navigate a 162-game schedule. And I can tell you, over the offseason when George Springer left, and knowing the relationship between Michael Brantley and George Springer, there was a lot of panic down here in Houston with fans realizing that Michael Brantley might not come back. But when he signed back, they fully embraced the fact that Michael Brantley wanted to be here in Houston, and we are all grateful that we get to watch this guy for another couple of seasons, because he has been remarkable.
We're talking with Jeff Blum, longtime big leaguer, now a Houston Astros TV analyst. You know, Jeff, obviously we all know the story about what happened in the World Series and the banging of the garbage cans. I'm sure you've been asked about it a million times. Last year, the team would have probably gotten booed a ton, but there were no fans. What has the fan reaction been like? And do the players feel somewhat vindicated after a not great season last year, that even without the garbage cans, they're having great success this year?
Yeah, that's a great question, and I think every time they go on the road, we re-answer those questions, or we're yeah. almost re-asking those questions because the curiosity is out there. Because every fan base is going to handle it a little bit differently. I would imagine that, you know, Cleveland is fans are going to let them have it just because of the postseason matchups that they've had in the past, mm-hmm. and they go out on the road, they get booed frequently, and I think these guys are actually. They understand it, but at the same time, they're not, they're trying not to acknowledge it. I think they've done a very good job of getting back and playing their game. I don't think they're going out and trying to prove anybody wrong. I think they're going out and trying to prove to everybody that this is who they are. They can hit. And it's just a shame that something like that is going to tarnish them for as long as their careers are going. But I think the more they're able to go out there and continue to compete, continue to hit, and put up numbers similar to, you know, those years where they did use the trash can, for lack of a better term, to try and, you know, enhance their success. You know, it's going to take a lot of work to get people off of that idea that they needed that to enhance their success, because having watched these guys and see how hard they work and see how much it affected them and they still go out and produce, these guys are very good hitters and very good competitors on the field, and they want to, you know, discourage anybody from thinking that they needed that.
Jeff, how do Astros fans feel about the whole cheating incident?
You know what? It was really tough, to be honest, when we first heard about it, because if you remember in 2017, Hurricane Harvey came through Houston and just wiped it out. People were hurting financially, physically, emotionally. And the one thing they had that was a shining light was that 2017 team. So when they eventually went on to win the World Series, you know, they kind of pinned it on the community and said that the community had, you know, helped them get through the World Series and they won it for them. And it was just this really great bonding and galvanizing moment when the Astros won it during such a hard time. And then to realize that, you know, something else was going on really tarnished it and took a lot of that joy away from the fans. So the initial reaction was, oh my gosh, I can't believe this happened, to I don't know how I feel about this team. And now it's back to, these guys are pretty good, they're our team, they're incredibly loyal, thank goodness, and they have just rallied around these guys and taken on all the heat that they take on social media. They still travel on the road and sit in the stands and listen to the booing and all the chanting that goes on, so mm-hmm. I give them credit mm-hmm. for fighting through this and staying with this team.
How big has Dusty Baker been in keeping the team on track these last couple of years?
He's been really good. You know, coming from the outside, I think it was really beneficial that they did get an outside voice and somebody who has been, you know, in the community, been in different environments in his throughout his career, you know, coming up in the, you know, the late 60s, early 70s in Atlanta, you know, being African-American, understanding the struggles that he's had to go through as a player and just a person in society, and then fighting through just playing in the major leagues and lasting as long as he had, managing teams, dealing with personalities, dealing with situations. I think it's really been very good for this ball club to have kind of that patriarchal father figure in Dusty Baker come in, because you guys know as well as I do, you look at stat sheets, Dusty did it all. Winning world championships, being an all-star, and then you look at what he's done as a manager, managing, you know, World Series contending teams and having a winning record and winning close to 2,000 games. This guy's done it all. So he's got an answer and an idea for everything these guys throw at him, and I think it's been really great for him to be around this ball club.
Jeff, we appreciate the time, man. Thank you for taking it. Enjoy your weekend. You guys don't travel, right? You're still not traveling, right? You're still in Houston.
Yeah, I wish. Yeah. You know what? I love going to Cleveland. It's one of those sneaky good spots on the road that everybody takes for granted. But no, we're not traveling yet.
Yeah, they got to get you. I mean, all the teams have full crowds. It seems silly that they're not letting the broadcasters travel at this point. Last year, I get it. But at this point, they should let you guys travel. But it's another discussion for another day.
Saving some money. Saving the money.
Well, yeah. All right. Thanks, Jeff. We appreciate
there it,
man.
Is.
Yeah.
Have a good one, guys. Thank you.
All right,
you
that's too. The truth. Hey, thanks, Jeff.
Yeah, there you go. Jeff Blum.
How do you order food for the office these days? How do you make sure it's on time and as ordered? How can you get it individually packaged? How? Easy Cater. When you order on EasyCater.com, the food comes as ordered and on time 98% of the time. And when there's a problem, which is practically never...
Thank you for calling Easy Cater.
You can reach someone in about 9 seconds. How do you order 24/7 from more than 80,000 restaurants? How? Easy Cater. Order 24/7 on EasyCater.com.
Dealing with adversity and finding ways to unify and overcome it will always be part of our future. The new season of Hope Through History, a documentary podcast presentation from C-13 Originals in association with the History Channel, written and narrated by me, John Meacham, features moments in our nation's past when we faced challenges as a country and as a world. Listen and follow Season 2 of Hope Through History, available now wherever you get your podcasts.